We begin tonight with a look at what's been called the most important public health study you've never heard of. It's known as the Adverse Childhood Experience Study.
The year is 1985. The location, Kaiser Permanente Medical Care Program in San Diego. Dr. Vincent Felitti, the medical director of a large program designed to help obese patients lose weight, is facing a puzzling problem. Just when many of his patients have begun to lose a noticeable amount of weight, they drop out of the program. He decides to meet with patients one-on-one to determine why. The answers are startling. He discovers that many of his patients had been sexually abused as children, and he realizes that for some of his patients, excess eating and weight gain are not simply a matter of lack of control or education. They are, in fact, a protective mechanism and a way of coping with the bad experiences from their past. After partnering with Dr. Robert Anda at the Centers for Disease Control, Dr. Felitti's investigation was expanded to cover 17,000 largely middle-class adult patients in the Kaiser Permanente system. The survey asked them about their history with 10 different potentially adverse childhood experiences, known as ACEs, grouped in three categories: abuse, physical, emotional, sexual; neglect, physical and emotional; and household dysfunction, mental illness, incarcerated household member, a mother who was treated violently, substance abuse, and divorce. For each type of adverse childhood experience, the person was given a point, and the points were tallied. For instance, a person whose parents were divorced and whose father was incarcerated and suffered from addiction received an ACE score of 3. Again, the researchers could not believe what they found. 67% had at least one ACE. Over 20% had 3 or more ACEs. 11% experienced 5 or more categories. The researchers determined that higher ACE scores correlated with an increase in risk for problems like substance abuse, smoking, and depression, and also for physical health problems like cancer, diabetes, stroke, and heart disease. And here's the most surprising part. Adverse childhood experiences make a person more susceptible to adult diseases, regardless of coping behaviors like smoking or substance abuse. Preventing disease, then, goes beyond exercising, eating right, and getting good medical care. It means reducing adverse childhood experiences.
The ACE study demonstrated that childhood trauma and adversity is much more prevalent than most people ever thought and has significant impact on both mental and physical health throughout the lifespan. In Kentucky, 25.8% of children have experienced 2 or more ACEs. We rank 42nd in the nation for prevalence of ACEs. This affects our healthcare system, our schools, our prisons, our workforce, and comes with huge financial costs. Recently, I was honored to interview Dr. Vincent Felitti himself about this groundbreaking study and what we all can learn from it, both as individuals and as a state. Dr. Felitti, thank you very much for your time. We really appreciate being able to connect with you.
Well, you're quite welcome.
Your study really focused and included white, Caucasian, middle-class folks. Yes. And so when we think about in terms of the applicability of the ACEs study to the population as a whole, why was it important to start or use that particular segment of the population?
Well, that's what we had. The population that we had in Kaiser Permanente, huge medical organization. I don't know if the name is known in Kentucky, but Kaiser Permanente is a nationwide medical care system that has approximately 12 to 13 million members in it. So everybody obviously has high-end medical insurance. 74% of the people had been to college, etc. Now, is that descriptive of every population in the world? My God, no. But given what we learned, if things are this bad in a clearly middle-class population, they surely don't get better. You know, if you're a recent immigrant from some war-torn corner of the earth, if you're part of an oppressed minority, if you're living in poverty on the street, et cetera.
Your study demonstrates that the unhealthy behaviors that we see in adults really could be coping strategies and mechanisms that come from traumatic experiences during their childhood. So can you talk a little bit more about that?
A recurrent theme in the obesity program was for people to flee at some point and regain all of their weight quickly. I have a number of television interviews with patients, video interviews with patients, where they make the point that obesity was protective. My wall was crumbling. You know, I don't want bariatric surgery because what would I do if I needed to be fat again? So that was the beginning of a whole series of counterintuitive observations that what was being perceived as the problem in public health certainly was a problem from a societal standpoint, but from the standpoint of the individual involved was often an unconsciously attempted solution to problems that we knew nothing about.
Dr. Felitti, for those adults who are watching this program tonight and they recognize that perhaps they have a significant number of ACEs and are challenged about what to do next, what would you say to them right now? What should they do?
Well, one thing that's a reasonable starting point is to start writing an autobiography of your life in 5-year segments. And if you have a computer, you can put that on the computer, you know, in a password-protected file. And that way you can go back and, you know, make additions to things that you hadn't thought about before, et cetera, just to set the story straight in your own mind. And the question then comes, well, how much trouble are those things causing me now? And if that's a serious problem, then the obvious approach would be psychotherapy. The problem with that is that psychotherapy, while a very effective approach, is also an inefficient approach. It's very time-consuming, hence costly, hence unaffordable to a large number of people. We found an alternative was hypnotherapy. If you can find an experienced hypnotherapist who's had experience working in medical situations, that can often be very useful because sometimes significant symptomatic relief can be attained in a very small number of visits, hence affordably. But a really good starting point is the autobiographical writing. That's been studied well and, you know, obviously has no cost attached to it. A great deal of advance can be made starting that way.
Journaling, I think many people would refer to it as. So looking at children, you know, what are some of the protective factors that can reduce the impact of ACEs and mitigate the impact of ACEs on children? What would you recommend there?
That's a key point. Having access to a supportive adult, you know, with luck, it could be somebody in the family, maybe a grandparent, what have you, could be a school teacher, you know, any, it could be a minister if you're a churchgoer, et cetera. Any supportive adult can be very, very meaningful. The old television program, Mr. Rogers' Neighborhood, was an excellent example of that, because in a way that program really had its function by supplying a supportive adult into the lives of many children who did not have such a person.
Kentucky is in the top 10 states in the prevalence of ACEs. So what would you, Dr. Felitti, say to policymakers and others who may be thinking about policy or systemic changes that could help bring those numbers down?
I would suggest that they do what 23 other states have already done, to pass legislation. Well, you know, first, obviously, to get the people of the legislature aware of what we found, and then pass legislation designed to support the routine collection of this information in everyday medical practice. For instance, in California, the legislature has passed legislation now putting up several hundred million dollars to, A, disseminate information about the ACE findings throughout the state to the public, and B, to provide an extra payment for any physician who is seeing a Medi-Cal patient who collects the ACE information and records it. Any physician who does that in California now will have $29 added to his fee, whatever it would have been for seeing that patient. So that has been a big step forward in terms of, you know, really getting this disseminated on a wide scale. In medicine, it has slowly gathered attention and acceptance, starting in pediatrics. Adult medicine, you know, largely avoidant at the present time. You know, that'll change, but it may take years, if not a couple of decades, for that to change meaningfully. In pediatrics, it's really catching on, with the American Academy of Pediatrics pushing it and so forth. An important point is how one gets this information. I mean, this is really a key point. If you attempt to get it face-to-face, that's likely to fail, because all of us, having, you know, learned all our lives that certain things one doesn't talk about, incest being one, or ask questions about, we found it was we're likely to do it clumsily the first few times and then decide, no, the hell with this, you know, that's not what I do. I'm a cardiologist or gastroenterologist or surgeon or what have you. What we found was that when we entered these questions and blended them into a 10-page medical history questionnaire filled out at home, not in the waiting room, that was highly accepted to patients. Many patients used to stop me in the hall on their way home at the end of visit two to thank me for asking, quote, those questions. And then go on to say how grateful they were that the examiner was still nice to them after hearing the dark secrets of their lives. Hmm. And I thought it's an important thing that asking, initially by an inert mechanism, and in the exam room then, he would say to a patient, I see on the questionnaire that you were the one who discovered your father's body when he hanged himself. You were repeatedly molested as a kid, etc. Can you tell me how that's affected you later in your life? And we listened, period. No humbug about, oh, I'm so sorry to hear that. That must have been awful, etc. No, we listened, period. And we did one other thing. We implicitly accepted that person by wanting to see them come back again. You know, and his patients in the hall would tell me, you know, they were really nice to me, they want to see me again, et cetera, as though they were expecting, you know, some disastrous response to learning these childhood experiences.
Yeah, very important. I'm glad you shared that, Dr. Felitti. Just in a final question to you, are there any misconceptions about the study that you'd like to set the record straight on?
I don't think the real issue is misconception. The real issue is, you know, ignorance of the study or its findings, which is still fairly widespread. Major discomfort with dealing with those findings, and hence avoidance. Those are the main issues.
Thank you, Dr. Vincent Felitti, for your time and your expertise and your contributions in this area. We really appreciate it.
Well, you're very welcome. Thank you.
We owe Dr. Felitti a debt of gratitude for his humanity and courage as he explored these complex issues and helped expose the widespread prevalence of trauma in childhood. Because of the ACE study, clinicians are beginning to ask, what happened to you, instead of what's wrong with you?